Thank you, Jeremy. And thank you to all of you for that warm welcome. I hope you're not too disappointed, but I don't regard myself as speaking about the Battle of Little Bighorn today. I'm going to be talking about commemoration of Little Bighorn today, rather than the battle itself. Although at the end of the lecture there will be time for questions, and if anyone wants to throw in any questions about the battle itself, I'll be happy to do my best to answer them. But I do want to stress at the very beginning that what I'm interested in today is performance, imagery, representation, and commemoration. And I want specifically to talk about the role of William F. Cody in early representations of issues related to the Great Sioux War of 1876-77, that included the Battle of Little Bighorn, and how those things have informed the development of popular ideas about the Battle of Little Bighorn. That's why the full title of my talk is displayed on the screen there, obviously on the poster we just said commemoration of Little Bighorn, but I want to use as examples the First Scalp for Custer, the appearances that Sitting Bull made with Buffalo Bill's Wild West in the 1885 season, and then the representations of Custer's Last Rally or Custer's Last Stand that were presented by the Wild West as three significant events whereby William F. Cody was involved at a crucial stage in developing some of the popular ideas about Custer's Last Stand and the Battle of Little Bighorn, as these have passed into popular consciousness, if you like, the way in which these things have been popularly remembered by American and broader audiences, rather than the events of 25th and 26th June 1876 in Montana. So what do I mean by these popular representations? Let's start with an example that I hope will be familiar to many of you. It's of course the one of the best known representations on film of Custer's Last Stand. It's a scene from Raoul Walsh's 1941 classic, They Died With Their Boots On. And it features a lot of familiar noises as well as familiar images. We start with the Garry Owen, which was the marching song of the 7th Cavalry, with gunfire over it. Then we have this small band of men fighting around the flag. There are guns going off. There's the sound of gunfire. There's the hand-to-hand combat with Indians. Then suddenly there's a bugle call. The music changes. We have Indians sweeping across the screen left to right. Then suddenly we focus again on the Custer figure, a man standing alone with just the flag of the guidon of the 7th Cavalry at his side. He's out of ammunition. He defiantly draws his sabre in the face of almost certain death. And then a rifle shot rings out from the Winchester of Crazy Horse, in inverted commas. He falls. The Indian snatches up the banner and rides off with his followers. We suspend our disbelief. We're not particularly bothered, I hope, about the fact that we've got a Mexican-Irish-American Crazy Horse shooting down an Australian-Irish-American George Armstrong Custer. We know what we're watching because it's playing on a number of images and ideas, sounds and images that are familiar and that we can associate with this notion of Custer's Last Stand. Where do these ideas come from? Let's start with Errol Flynn. We've started off looking at Errol Flynn, and we've agreed that we've been quite happy to dismiss from our mind the idea that what we're actually seeing is a, I don't know even if he himself would even have preferred to be known as Tasmanian rather than actually Australian, but it doesn't bother us because what we're seeing is familiar. It's a representation that we accept. And a lot of people with an interest in Custer think that in film, and there have been a large number of Custers on film, that Errol Flynn is the best or one of the best. I am in that particular school of thought. I think Errol Flynn was a great Custer. Now, you cannot even strongly argue that they died with their boots on is based on historical fact. It's not. It is popular entertainment. From a historical perspective, an awful lot of what's in it is nonsense. However, what is it about Errol Flynn that makes him such a good Custer to those of us who have studied Custer? Well, you know, I sum it up like this. Nobody played Custer like Errol Flynn since Custer himself. Because Custer played the part of General Custer from the time of his promotion to that rank during the Civil War. Custer, throughout his life, carefully managed a number of constructs of his own image. Custer played General Custer. Custer developed a very striking and recognisable style during his Civil War career. You see there a representation of the young Custer and of the Civil War General Custer. Look at the way he looks at the camera. Look at the angle of his hat, the red neckerchief, the sailor style blouson. This is not just a regular army issue uniform. This is a man developing, cultivating, and presenting an image. A man playing Custer, playing General Custer, maybe we should say. He was very, very adept at using the press and magazines of his day to project the image of General Custer throughout the Civil War. When he moved on to the plains, he developed a different image, a scout image, in inverted commas. We'll say slightly more about the scout image in a couple of minutes. But he develops this image of himself as a frontiersman. Look at the way he's photographed in groups with Indians. Look at the way he's photographed in groups that in settings that suggest Custer as hunter, as scout, as frontiersman. Nobody played Custer like Errol Flynn since Custer himself, would be my argument. Before I go into the detail of what I want to say about representation and commemoration, having begun by saying that I don't want to talk about the battle itself, I do want to make it clear to everyone that that's not an indication of disrespect for the hundreds of young men that lost their lives over those 2 days in Montana in June 1876. There were many young men, whether they were Irish, German, Iowa farm boys, Lakota, Tsitsistas, who lost their lives that day. And I wish to stress at this point that I think it's important to commemorate the reality of what happened there. And I don't wish that to in any sense be diminished by looking at the ways in which commemoration as representation and performance has informed popular cultural ideas about Custer and Custer's Last Stand. Custer was not the only man of his generation who was very self-consciously developing an idea of himself and involved in projecting an image of himself. And if you think about that image of Custer as the frontiersman that I've just presented to you, and look now at that group photograph from William F. Cody's Buffalo Bill Combination when he was appearing on stage in the early 1870s. I hope you'll see that there are a number of striking parallels in the visual imagery that was being adopted by these scouts, these knights of the prairie, who were presenting ideas about their own experiences on the Western Plains to theatre audiences in Chicago, New York, Wilmington, Delaware. What people described in those days as the United States. People would come out to Montana Territory or Dakota Territory, and they would talk about leaving the States to come out here. So these people were going back to the States to present this idea of the Western frontier, the Western frontiersman, with this sense, this idea that there was authenticity in what they were doing, because these were the real people who were out there on the plains, who were now giving an authentic representation of their experiences for American audiences. Two key figures that I would like to highlight in relation to these representations, in addition to Cody himself, would be John M. Burke and Jack Crawford. Now, I don't want to say very much more about Jack Crawford today. I think it's important to mention him because he had an extremely important role in and around the Black Hills at the time of the Great Sioux War of 1876-77. He would subsequently develop a number of significant representations, in particular through his lectures and through his poetry, which also informed developments of popular ideas about Custer's Last Stand and Little Bighorn. I don't have time to go into those today, but I don't want to just pass over them without at least mentioning it. And I will come back to John M. Burke, who was such a crucial figure in the development of the Buffalo Bill idea, and who played a crucial role in bringing to the Wild West Sitting Bull. So I'll come back to Burke when I talk about Sitting Bull in the Wild West in a few minutes. But I want to move on now to talk about the first of the major representations that are relevant to the role that William F. Cody played in how Custer's Last Stand and the events surrounding Custer's Last Stand entered into popular consciousness for US and subsequently broader audiences. The first representation that the Buffalo Bill Combination offered that related to these events was the Red Right Hand, or First Scalp for Custer, that was presented on the stage within 6 months of the events at Little Bighorn. And it wasn't even the first stage representation of Little Bighorn. There had been at least two previous representations by other companies. Both of these representations by other companies purported to present the events of Custer's Last Stand. They were flops. They only ran to a few performances. Why should that be? Well, clearly, at this time, the dominant idea within United States popular consciousness was that the United States, by an inevitable progress, was expanding westward. And it's very difficult to satisfy the expectations of your audience at that time if you're actually representing a defeat for American forces by people that might largely, in the eastern states, as we would call them now, have been regarded as uncivilized savages. So the initial representations on stage of Custer's Last Rally, Custer's Last Stand, were disastrous. Cody was in a very fortunate position, in that relatively soon after the events, he was able to present something that in its title represents a commemoration of the events of Little Bighorn without addressing the events themselves, and by presenting a United States victory as a first scalp for Custer. And that gives Cody a significant advantage in terms of audience expectations. And in fact, when you look at the various historical battles that Cody, both in the combination through this melodrama and subsequently in the arena performances of the Buffalo Bill exhibition, if you look at the ways in which historical battles are represented, the one that's represented most often is the one that happened in July of 1876 at Warbonnet Creek, Nebraska, because it allowed William F. Cody and his various performance troops to provide a victory for American audiences as a commemoration of Custer. With a stress on authenticity, of course, because Cody had actually been there. It was Cody who killed Hiova'ahe, a young Cheyenne man whose name would properly translate as yellow hair, although in these authentic representations he was always referred to as Yellow Hand, a mistranslation of his name. So let's think what we understand by the concept of authenticity in a representation. I'd like to ask you to spend a few minutes looking at a film clip from 1913. As I've already said, this idea of the red right hand or the first scalp for Custer was one of the most commonly performed representation by William F. Cody's various ventures into the world of performance. And one of his last ventures was to be involved in film projects. So I'm going to play for you now a film of the first scalp for Custer. It's a silent film, so I hope it doesn't provide too much of a distraction from watching it if I continue talking while it plays in the background. But I want you to think what you understand by authenticity as you watch it. And I'll just comment on a few things that would certainly not be authentic in what you're seeing. If anyone's ever seen a Cheyenne camp, and I had the fortune in 2002 to see a language project up in the Northern Cheyenne Reservation where they were using old hide teepees. That looks nothing like a Cheyenne camp. These men are clearly wearing Lakota costumes. The teepee at the front there that's flapping in the breeze and falling over as you watch, that's not the sort of thing that happens with real American Indian teepees out in these plains. In an Indian village, the vast majority of the population would have been female rather than male. People lived in these villages. They didn't tend to dress up in all their finery and dance about. And if people went to war, and the Cheyenne people that encountered the 5th Cavalry in July 1876 were heading north into a war zone. But they were not going to war. They were travelling not as warrior societies, but as a people, men, women and children. You only have to look at that image to see all the familiar elements of the Buffalo Bill that we have represented upstairs in our Buffalo Bill Museum. And I specifically stress Buffalo Bill rather than William F. Cody. Buffalo Bill as a construct. Wouldn't that be wonderful if back in the days when there was war out in these plains, it was as easy as that to discover hostile Indians, and as easy as that to hide from them once you'd discovered them. I must say, anyone who knows anything about military history would say, that's not a 5th Cavalry 1876 uniform that any of those men are wearing. And the sort of tents that you might have glimpsed in the background were not the sort of tents that were being used by US forces, at least until the time of the Spanish-American War of 1898. Not doing very well in what we might regard as authenticity so far, are we? So anyway, off we go to war. Then we have the Cheyennes covering their trail. I have no idea what on earth those people are doing. Don't look like Cheyennes to me. But it looks more like they're engaging in some sort of parade rather than anything that could cover the trail. You don't need to know a great deal about riding horses. You don't need to know a great deal about how to cover a trail without being able to say that's not going to cut the mustard. But hey, here come the cavalry riding to the rescue after the Indians. The Indians come through first. And then we'll see the cavalry chasing them. Now, I would strongly recommend to any of you that have an interest in the historical events of July 1876 to read Paul Hedren's book with a foreword by Russell about the events of War Bonnet Creek in July 1876. You'll find that it wasn't a case of cavalry heroically riding to the rescue in pursuit of a column of Cheyenne dressed as Sioux. The fight itself, which we're seeing now, there you are with people dancing with knives while others circle about waving their arms in the air, just like you would if you thought one of your best friends' life might be in danger. But hey, that's what matters. The iconic image, the first scalp for Custer. You can see that image there more clearly presented than is the case on a grainy black and white film that's almost 100 years old now. Look at the elements of the image that you see represented in front of you. The scout costumes that we've seen both on Custer and from the Buffalo Bill combination photograph. The scalp and war bonnet held aloft in victory. The red right hand, i.e. the bloody knife that has scalped Heovehe. And the cavalry presented riding into battle. And look how large the cavalry are by comparison to the Indian. There's a sort of idea of dominance, of maybe them chasing them away. These are the sort of images that clearly did find the appeal to popular audiences in the United States within a few months of Custer's demise, and that did give rise to the most commonly represented performance of a historical event that William F. Cody's, a historical battle that William F. Cody's combination and Buffalo Bill exhibition ever represented. This killing of a young Cheyenne man had become a chivalrous duel against an evil adversary. But I wouldn't want you to think that that in and of itself suggests that what we're dealing with was tremendous theatre. It was, as one reviewer said, blood and thunder drama as gory as the best of them. With more Indians laid out cold than Custer, Terry and Crook ever killed in all of their campaigns. Casualties at War Bonnet Creek, July 1876. One man, Heovehe, yellow hair. What does it say about success compared to authenticity. An awful lot of the success that Buffalo Bill's Wild West enjoyed, and I'm moving on here to talk more about the Wild West because of the historical period that the Buffalo Bill combination functioned in, I want to now move forward to looking at the time when Sitting Bull was involved with the Wild West. An awful lot of the success that the Wild West enjoyed, I would argue, was down to the work of John M. Burke and his publicity department that laid the groundwork, in many cases travelling in advance of the Wild West exhibition, feeding stories to the press, cultivating relationships with the press, entertaining the press at times so lavishly that when John M. Burke sent his expense accounts back to Joel Keane, who was the treasurer of the Buffalo Bill exhibition, we're led to believe that there was some colourful language used among Cody and Salisbury and Keane about the amount of money that was being spent by Burke. But people recognise now, people that study marketing recognise that Burke was in many ways ahead of his time in cultivating and managing that brand image associated with Buffalo Bill. And I would strongly argue that a lot of the success was actually down to not just the fact that Cody and companies were offering a tremendous product for a market, to a market that was ready for it, but also because of the ways in that which that market was being cultivated and developed by the genius that was John M. Burke. And John M. Burke was closely involved with the idea that it would be a great coup, pun entirely intended, to get Sitting Bull, now that he had returned from Canada, to come and appear with the Wild West. John M. Burke is reported in some sources as being himself a linguist and speaking a number of languages. I'm not entirely convinced by the evidence that I have seen. However, in the 1885 programme, he is presented as speaking Lakota. Not very good Lakota, but he is presented as speaking Lakota when he introduces Sitting Bull to William F. Cody. And we can see in the photograph there, that's a photograph from the time of the combination, that Burke cultivated quite early on this idea of his close relationship, identification with Indian people. And it was Burke who approached Tatanki Otake, the great Ungpapa Lakota spiritual leader, to come and appear with Buffalo Bill's Wild West exhibition. And when he did so, that's, I'm afraid, slightly cut off, a famous photograph of Cody and Tatanki Otake together in Canada, when he had gone there to appear with the Wild West, or had travelled there with the Wild West. It was Burke who was the signatory to the contract that Sitting Bull signed with the Wild West. You know, a number of years ago, when old fogies like me, who'd already been teaching in universities for 12 years, were told that we had to start using this newfangled thing called PowerPoint to enhance our lectures, the guy who was training us said, you have to remember that PowerPoint is a visual medium, and so every word that you put on a PowerPoint slide should be regarded as an admission of defeat. So in presenting that slide to you, I should obviously say, I surrender. One thing that he did stress also was that if you do feel you have to put words up, just don't read them out at the people that are sitting there in front of you and can read them for themselves. So I don't want to read out to you what I've presented before you. I'm assuming that you will have had the chance to read what's there on screen. The only thing that I would remark on is I think it's very interesting that Burke, the man who's so closely identified with this idea, you don't call it the Wild West Show, it's an exhibition, it's educational. Look at the wording that is used in relation to the Wild West exhibition in this contract. Sitting Bull had sole rights to sell his own photographs and his own autographs. Tatanki Yotake clearly had a sense of image and presence and the transactional commercial value associated with who he was and how he would be perceived by the publics at the time of signing the contract, before any appearances had taken place. Tatanki Yotake did not figure in any performance representations when he appeared with the Wild West. He was introduced, he and a group of, according to the contract, five other Lakota men who travelled with him. I've only been able to identify with certainty four of the men who travelled with him. Five other Lakota men were travelling with him. They were introduced, they were presented, they paraded around. Then they sat and watched the performance. If we contrast how Sitting Bull was being represented in the press of the time with how he was presented in the Wild West programme for 1885, something very interesting emerges. There was a small amount of positive representation of Sitting Bull in the contemporary press. But more commonly, the press spoke of his Berber barbarities, referring to him as the notorious Sitting Bull or the Sioux chief of Custer notoriety. He was being described as a scalper of distinction. You look at the 1885 programme, and he's medicine man, correct. The Sioux order of priesthood, correct. And counsellor, correct. Insofar as these are appropriate translations of Lakota terms, that Lakota speakers who can serve within their own traditions the memory of Tatanki Yotake, including his great-grandson, a man that I'm very happy to call a personal friend, Ernie Lapointe, a man that I'm very happy to say will again be at this very podium in mid next month on the 16th or 17th of August. So I would strongly encourage any of you who can be here to hear Ernie speak about his great-grandfather to come along. Consulting head of his nation, correct. Napoleon of the Indian race, that's a bit more difficult to justify in Lakota terms. I'm not sure if Tatanki Yotake or any of the Lakota men who were travelling with him would have known a great deal about who Napoleon was. But every other word that's used in describing him, in referring to him, in talking about who he was as a person within Lakota culture and society can be tied up to the way in which he's represented in the Wild West programme. Where is the authenticity? I think what the Wild West programme says about Sitting Bull is considerably more authentic than the way in which he was being presented in the popular press of the time. During the 1885 show, one of the things that was presented was the red right hand or first scalp for Custer. And Sitting Bull sat through it all and watched. There is only one press report that I've been able to find that actually describes the attitude of Sitting Bull as he was sitting watching the performance, and it says he sat and watched it as meek as a lamb. What might that suggest to us about what Sitting Bull thought of the authenticity of how the red right hand or first scalp for custom was being presented. Almost a year and a half later, Buffalo Bill's Wild West first presented Custer's last rally. They actually, 10 years on from the events of Little Bighorn, 1876, had reached a point at which they had found a way of representing those events to an American audience. And the way in which they represented these events to an American audience were entirely lacking in verisimilitude. You couldn't, by any stretch of the imagination, describe what was being presented as authentic or realistic. I'm quoting now directly from the 1887 Wild West program, with some commentary of my own interjected. What they presented in the 1886-87, which was the first of these representations of Custer's last rally, with an emphasis on authenticity, was almost a mini play divided into two specific scenes. The first scene was a military post on the frontier, and the second scene, the camp of Sitting Bull and his warriors on the Little Bighorn River. The action begins with the arrival of a scout at the stockade, announcing the discovery of a village of hostile Indians. The bugle call, "Boots and Saddles," is sounded. The troops mount up and they ride off. Second scene, the Indian village. The soldiers attack. The charge is repulsed. The 7th Cavalry fall into an ambush, which results in, and I quote, "the reddest page of savage history, the Custer Massacre, or the fall of brave General Custer and his entire command, not one living to tell the tale," end quote. How authentic is that? Not very authentic at all. There were hundreds of survivors of the 7th Cavalry. It just so happens that none of them were with the five companies that rode behind the hills initially, down towards the far end of the Indian villages. None of the people who were there after the departure of the Crow Scouts lived to tell the tale. But hundreds of others of Custer's command survived. What is it then that helped to make the way in which the last stand was represented by Cody so significant for how Custer and Little Bighorn have been remembered? Well, I would actually say, I would argue that there are three key contributing factors to the enduring heroic images associated with Custer's last stand. And they reside in three particular persons: Frederick Whittaker, Elizabeth Bacon Custer, and William F. Cody. Frederick Whittaker wrote the first biography of Custer, the first major biography of Custer that was issued after his death. In critical terms, we would describe it maybe more as hagiography, i.e. life of a saint, than biography. A lot of it by modern terms would be regarded as plagiarism. He takes huge tracts of Custer's own work, My Life on the Plains, and he just changes pronouns to say he did this, he did that, rather than I did this, I did that. And he presents a completely fictionalised account of what happened at Little Bighorn that is little more than a polemical argument. It was Reno's fault, it was Reno's fault, it was Reno's fault. I'm sorry if the idea of Reno and whether or not he was to blame is not necessarily understandable to all of you, but I know that there are a number of people with a more specialist knowledge of these events in the audience, and that will be significant for them. Elizabeth Bacon Custer was a fabulous widow. She played the part of the widow of a fallen hero for 33 years after her husband's death. And she wrote 3 eulogistic volumes, praising her husband, commemorating him heroically, and ensuring that any negative representation of her husband that she became aware of was stomped on insofar as she was able. She was a very, very powerful, very, very interesting woman. And when William F. Cody started to represent Custer's last rally, Custer's last stand, the grieving widow, who had never accepted any of the invitations to go to commemorations at the battlefield, attended a performance of Custer's last rally, represented by William F. Cody. She subsequently wrote to Cody, thanking him for all that he had done to keep her husband's memory green and make him an idol among the children and young people. By the time that Cody and company represent Little Bighorn, the audiences have been more sensitized to the idea of grieving for a fallen hero and the ability to heroically commemorate his fall. Now, I have to say, representations of Little Bighorn didn't make it past 1898 in United States representations of Buffalo Bill's Wild West exhibition. There were some subsequent performances of Custer's Last Stand in Europe. But in 1898, there was the small matter of the United States winning a war against Spain and becoming a real international superpower, as it has been ever since. And the ability to represent heroically the events of the victory on San Juan Hill by the Rough Riders was something that displaced the representation of Little Bighorn for the 1899 season. And Little Bighorn was never represented again for American audiences by Buffalo Bill's Wild West. So where does that take us when we compare representations and commemorations from those first 20 years after the events to the commemoration of the real events? I think the reception that these 3 presentations received and the way in which we can find out about them from the contemporary press coverage, each suggests that they were suited to the audiences of the time. The way in which the Red Right Hand first scalp for Custer was the first financially successful play on the stage that commemorated events related to Custer and the War of 1876-77. The ways in which the appearance of Sitting Bull with the Wild West Exhibition was undoubtedly a great coup for the Wild West, and the ways in which the representations of Little Bighorn itself, with the endorsement of the by then very publicly recognised figure of Custer's grieving widow, I would argue are the reasons why William F. Cody played such a significant role in the commemoration of Little Bighorn within the first 20 years of the battle having taken place. If anyone would like to get in touch with me for any further information about the events that I've been discussing today, I do have a more academic paper for more specialist readerships about this issue that's going to be published in June of next year. And if anyone wants to read that when it comes out, then you can contact me and I'll ensure that you're able to get access to that. But beyond that, I would like to offer my thanks to Papers of William F. Cody project here at the BBHC and the McCracken Research Library for the support that I've enjoyed in preparing this presentation. I'd like to thank Old Army Press for permission to use the 1913 film clip. I'd like to thank my home institution of University of Strathclyde School of Humanities for enabling me to be here this summer to be working on the Papers of William F. Cody project. But most of all, I would like to thank all of you for having sat through my presentation and invite you now to ask any questions that you might have. So, Gramargav, thank you.